Well, Russia's assault on Ukraine continues. Most recently on Wednesday, Russian forces bombed key areas in the capital, Kyiv. Biden, however, that is President Joe Biden of the United States, arrived in Brussels for some high-level NATO discussions as to where this entire war is headed next and what NATO's response will or will not be. And so Thursday's meetings in Brussels will bring together the world's most powerful military alliance for an extraordinary summit, where leaders will decide on troops, sanctions, and other measures designed to end war toward Ukraine and to bring Russian President Vladimir Putin to his knees. I think we all know sanctions. I mean, it's like, how many more rounds of sanctions will there be? How many of them will bring Putin to his knees? We're going to get into a little bit about where Russian oligarchs are storing their money later on in the show. But a lot of what is being discussed right now is what Vladimir Putin could do next based on intelligence reports. So the next phase, three pressing threats are looming over this summit, requiring the alliance to figure out its response and whether military intervention would be needed. So far, it's been off the table. So mistaken fire on an allied nation, cyber attacks to critical infrastructure of a NATO member state, and the possibility of chemical or biological warfare within Ukraine. Remember, these were all discussions that have been happening with Russia's aggression before in previous wars, like against Syria. And you know, some of the intelligence is looking pretty strong that there might be a chemical attack. Or even worse, let's say attacking a nuclear reactor, which it already has done, but thankfully that didn't actually lead to any kind of nuclear meltdown. But security experts are super worried. So this is according to the European Union research. If Russia had fired on one of the reactors that happened to be online, nuclear reactors, that would have caused a nuclear disaster. And we'd basically be looking at trying to evacuate a quarter of Europe, maybe half of Europe, depending on the wind. Wow, okay, so we're leaving this up to the weather. I hear there's weather, it goes up, it goes down. David Shuster, your reaction to this sort of reassessment that NATO is doing right now, based on the fact that Russia is not, it doesn't look like they're stopping anytime soon, despite the heavy casualties.
Yeah, I think this is a very sensitive time in the war, because given that Russia has setbacks, there's the expectation that Russia will sort of follow its doctrine of escalation in order to somehow de-escalate, and whether that's chemical weapons, biological weapons. I mean, the Russian military can interchange those with their artillery shells. And it's not just that as well. There's a working group that the Biden administration has assembled for the prospects of a tactical nuclear weapon. The idea that Russia would decide to clear out a space on the battlefield or one of the cities by using a nuclear shell that gets loaded into a tank or a plane. And then what? And it might be hard to detect at first. So there's all sorts of scenarios the Biden administration is preparing for. And I think that's all they can really do, is prepare, hope for the best, prepare for the worst, and make it very clear, look, if there is the use of biological or chemical weapons in Ukraine or a nuclear weapon, there is the very real possibility that the radiation or that the chemical agents fan out across NATO states. And at that point, the Biden administration has said, look, even if it is launched in Ukraine, but if it affects a NATO member, that is going to be a violation and there's going to be response. And I think that's the right approach.
Yeah, I mean, my mind is always like, well, I don't want to trigger a World War III, you know? But at the same time, you have to wonder how far we let Russia go. And my mind obviously goes to Syria. We're going to look at some of the similar tactics Russia's using in Ukraine as it did in Syria, but my mind goes to the sarin gas that was used in Syria, the number of children who died, and the red line that Obama put down, so to speak, that Joe Biden in this case has not put down. But Obama did kick it to Congress, right, and said, look, you know, we all know that we're war weary from 2+ ridiculous, idiotic wars that killed a lot of civilians and veterans alike. So what do you want to do now that Bashar al-Assad has used these chemical weapons? And I think there's a similar calculation, and I wonder if Biden would even leave this to Congress to talk about.
Yeah, I'm not sure he would leave it to Congress, but I think there is a calculation that's being made by the Biden administration, by a number of his national security officials, that they think, and this is, look, I don't necessarily agree, but they think there are several steps between US and Russian forces possibly being engaged with each other and a full-scale World War III nuclear exchange. That they think there's a possibility that if, let's say, Russia used chemical or biological weapons, the United States then said, okay, now we're gonna try to put together some sort of no-fly zone, and maybe US aircraft are taking on Russian surface-to-air missile systems. They can still have that exchange, and Russian troops and US troops might still kill each other. But there's still this betting in the Biden administration that that would still be several steps short of either the United States or Russia then escalating towards nuclear weapons that would be fired across continents at each other. So, you know, there are these very intense discussions. And is it possible that Russian and American troops could meet on the battlefield and not have it escalate? I suppose it's possible. It's also possible that it could escalate. So, but there's all sorts of scenarios to consider.
Sure, sure. And just so everyone knows, the losses on the Russian side are incredible. I mean, it's 7,000 on the low end Russian troops who have lost their lives. And Russia's not admitting to any of that, but that is an exorbitant number considering, in terms of modern warfare, more than the soldiers who were lost in Afghanistan, for example, US soldiers. Some interesting news though, because after a lot of pressure from NATO countries and European countries, this is just today, the Biden administration has agreed it will accept 100,000 Ukrainian refugees from who are fleeing, obviously, Russia's invasion. So in an announcement, the White House said that refugees would be received through the quote, full range of legal pathways, including the US Refugee Admissions Program, which leads to permanent residence or a green card. Others may be granted visas or humanitarian parole, a form of entry offered to people requiring swift, temporary safe haven in wartime and other emergency situations. That's a huge development and also very different from our responses to other crises. Obviously, thinking about Syria again, we all remember what was going on, especially under Trump, trying to prevent any so-called Muslim refugees from coming into this country. And also, let's remember, we're still operating under Title 42, which is a Trump-era immigration law that says because of the pandemic, immigrants are not allowed to seek asylum in the United States. That's being lifted, I assume, in this case, and for a particular subset of refugees. But David, what are your thoughts on that?
Well, you know, on the one hand, I'm like, well, this is great. I'm glad the Biden administration has said 100,000. I guess the question that I would have for you, Francesca, is when you consider what there are 3 million Ukrainian refugees who have left the country. So we're talking about the United States has agreed to accept maybe 3%. Is that enough? I mean, maybe we're not equipped to be able to take more and with all the logistics that it entails. But it's not that much of a lift in terms of what the United States is committing to. And there's part of me that wishes that the United States would say, you know what, we're gonna take at least 100,000. We're gonna try to take 250,000 or 400,000, whatever it is. However many people wanna come to the United States, fine, we will deal with it. It feels like that would be a little bit more of a leadership position. But what are your thoughts on this?
Yeah, I mean, when you actually put it into the scale of the refugees, you're totally right. My initial reaction was, wow, 100,000, that seems like a lot. Again, considering that when it comes to Central American migrants or when it comes to, you know, migrants coming from or refugees coming from the Middle East, it's like, no, none of them, 2,000. And y'all can correct me on what numbers we've actually accepted from Syria, but it's not a lot. It is low, it is lower than 100,000. So that's where my mind goes, but you're totally right that in the grand scale, countries like Germany or Moldova or other neighboring countries in Europe are going to be feeling this far more than the United States will. So I'm glad we're wising up a little bit, and I'm curious, you know, is the right wing gonna freak out the refugees coming from Ukraine?
Yeah, I mean, that's a great question, because you think about it, some of the right wing has already started to suggest, oh, well, you Ukrainians are European, they're white, they're more like us than people from Central America or from Africa. Well, if that's your argument, then okay, then we should welcome even more. I mean, I have a feeling that the right is gonna find some way to say, oh, this is another plot by Democrats to somehow steal the election because you're gonna register all these people to vote and push your thumb on the scale. So I'm sure the right wing is gonna come up with some reason to sort of circle the wagons and say, you know what, we're gonna focus just on America, America first, to hell with refugees, it's not our problem. That'll come, but hopefully in the meantime, the Biden administration can get the logistics and get everything going to get these 100,000 or more into the United States and help them facilitate a new life.
Agreed. And thank you for Sophie, our producer, just checking that actually the United States has received less than 9,000 Syrian refugees since that civil war started and effectively ended because Syria, Bashar al-Assad, with the help of Russia, actually won that war to the detriment of millions and millions of refugees and about 25,000 civilians lost.
For more political news breakdowns, interviews, stories of activism, and me trying my hardest to care about the occasional big celebrity news story, subscribe to our YouTube channel at youtube.com/thedamagereport. And you can ring the bell wherever it is so you don't miss anything.